Here we go again, my mind racing, and I can't seem to win. All these crazy thoughts and feelings, it's like it never ends until your voice breaks through my noise. I know I'm not alone, not alone. You fight my battles. If I would just be still, why would I keep running when you're here? I'll just be quiet and let you speak through the silence. Here I am, no more hiding. You are in this moment, I won't fight it. I'll be quiet. I don't need to know what comes next. Tomorrow's in your hands. I can trust you with my future, 'cause you're already there. I hear your voice pull me forward, and I know I'm not alone, not alone. Away with the distractions, I wanna hear what's true. The only words that matter, they come from you.
A few questions to ask God if I saw him here.
What was it like 100 years ago?
Is the Loch Ness Monster real? Are dinos real? Can I meet a dinosaur?
Why don't we get to see you all the time?
I have a question. How does gravity work?
How big is the universe? How many grains of sand?
Why did you create Earth?
Can we bring dinos back to life?
Do aliens live on any of the planets?
How was I when I was like a little baby?
Where's the Garden of Eden?
Is it possible that I could be an animal?
Why can't junk food be healthy? What is truth?
Can I love like you do?
Why do we feel pain?
Do I have a room in heaven?
What does it feel to die?
Why did you send your only son and not want any angel to die on the cross for us? Does that mean that my parents could send me to die for others?
What is the best way to spread your word?
What is my future going to be like?
Hello, everybody. Welcome. Happy Sabbath. I want to invite you today, wherever you are, to just go ahead and sing and lift your voices with us as we start our worship service today. Let's sing together.
finding now, where the grace runs as deep as your scars. You pulled me from the clay, set me on a rock, called me by your name, made my heart whole again. Lifted up, and my knees know it's all for your glory. I might stand with more reasons to sing than to fear. You pulled me from the clay, set me on a rock, called me by heart whole again.
So here I stand.
So here I stand, high in surrender. I need you now. I hold my heart now and forever. My soul cries out. Once I was broken, you loved my whole has no hold on me, 'cause your grace holds me now. And that grace owns the ground where the grave did. All my shame remains left for dead in your wake. You crashed those age-old gates, left no stone unturned. You stepped out of that grave and shouldered me all the way. So here I stay, high in surrender. I need you now. Hold my heart now and forever. My soul cries out. Once I was broken, you loved my whole heart. Through sin has no hold on me, 'cause your grace holds me now. Healed and forgiven, look where my chains are now. Death has no hold on me, 'cause your grace holds that ground. And your grace holds me now. And your grace holds me now. Your grace holds me now.
Once I was broken.
Once I was broken, you loved my whole heart. Through sin has no hold on me, 'cause your grace holds me now. Healed and forgiven, look where my chains are now. Death has no hold on me, 'cause your grace holds that ground. And your grace holds me now. 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 Thank you. is a grace where the heart is undefined. Another way and the walls are closing in. When I look at the space between where I used to be and this reckoning, I know I will never be alone. There was another in the fire standing next to me. There is another in the waters holding back the seas. And should I ever need reminding of how I've been set free, there is a cross that bears the burden, another tied for me. There is another in the fire. All my debt left a debt between the walls. No longer a slave to my sin anymore. And should I fall in the space between what remains of me and this reckoning, either way I won't bow to the things of this world. And I know I will never be alone. There is another in the fire standing next to me. There is another in the water holding back the seas. Should I ever need reminding what power set me free, there is a grave that holds nobody. Now the power lives in me. There is another in the fire. There is another in the fire. Oh, there is another in the fire. There is another in the fire. There is no other name but the name that is Jesus. Was and still is and will be through it all. So come what may in the space between all the things unseen and this reckoning. And I know I will never be alone. Oh, I know I will never be alone. There'll be another in the fire standing next to me. There'll be another in the waters holding back the seas. Should I ever need reminding how good you've been to me, I'll count the joy of every battle, 'cause I know that's where you'll be. There'll be another in the fire. Another in the fire. Be another in the fire. Be another in the fire.
The praying of the word today is found in one of the most popular Psalms, Psalms 23. The Lord is our shepherd, we shall not want. He makes us lie down in green pastures. He leads us beside still waters. He restores our soul. He leads us in paths of righteousness for his name's sake. Even though we walk through the valley of the shadow of death, we will fear no evil, for you are with us. Your rod and your staff, they comfort us. You prepare a table before us in the presence of our enemies. You anoint our head with oil. Our cup overflows. Surely, goodness and mercy shall follow us all the days of our lives, and we shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen.
Thank you, Stephanie. Good Morning Church is now offering time in Hollywood. Just as we prayed Psalm 23, I was pondering on the first verse. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. Through the simple illustration of God being our shepherd, we see how God tenderly takes care of us to provide, guide, and protect us. I remember a time when I was in college and I was trying to ponder what was going to be my next steps in life. I knew that I really wanted to go to graduate school, but I also knew that I wanted to take some time off to be a student missionary for a year. After praying about it for a little while, God offered me the opportunity to do both. I ended up being able to go to an amazing placement where I not only learned so much about myself, about God, and just trusting Him in the small and big things, but He also provided the monetary amount that I needed to get there. He provided safety for me and all my fellow missionaries, and provided me with a family of those who I served with, who I love and cherish. Not only did that goodness from God stop there, but when I returned to the States, I was able to go to graduate school with classmates who really helped enrich and really got me through my time in Loma Linda. Without them, I don't think I would have made it through. So as you see with my story, and I'm sure in many of yours too, God not only protects, but He guides and He provides for us. Now, if you have the opportunity at this time, please make sure that you can donate what you can to the church. God bless.
Hi, church family. I wanted to share some of the hard questions that I have had recently with all of you. As some of you know, my dad passed away unexpectedly in September of 2019. There was no prior illness that he had. He didn't have a disease. There was nothing wrong with him. And one day his heart just stopped. Needless to say, this has been the hardest thing that I've experienced in my life. I'm I just turned 26 this year, and it's crazy to think that when I was only 25, back in September, that he passed away. My dad was my best friend in the whole world. We talked on the phone every single day, and this has been an extreme loss for me. In September, my mom called me on the phone. I was in Target, and she said that I needed to hurry and come out to Palm Desert, where I'm from, because my dad's heart had stopped. When I got her phone call and I heard her crying on the phone, I immediately thought, please, please don't let it be my dad. Please let it be something happened to my grandparents, you know, who have had long lives. I was just thinking in my head, don't let it be dad. And my whole body went numb, completely numb. I ran out of the Target and started the worst drive of my life out to Palm Desert, not knowing if my dad was alive or not. The whole time that I was driving out there, I was pleading with God, pleading, just begging God. I even said to God, and I said, God, you don't even need to answer any other prayers for me. You don't need to give me any other blessings. Just start my dad's heart. Just start his heart. And I said to God, I believe that you can do this. I believe that you can perform miracles. And that night, when I actually did get to the hospital, I walked into the ER, not knowing for sure what had happened. And I saw my whole family was there. My extended family was there. Church members were there because my dad was a pastor. And so there were pastor friends of his that were there, people from my home church. And when I saw everybody standing there together, it was as if in slow motion, they all turned and looked at me at the same time. And they just slowly nodded their heads like this. And in that moment, I collapsed. It felt like my whole world had collapsed, but I also myself did collapse, and I just fell to the ground in the ER, and I started screaming. I started saying, no, no. I couldn't believe it. I was in complete shock. I had talked to my dad on the phone that day, and he was fine. He was his normal self. He was joking with me. He was encouraging me about my job and about my work, and just being the great dad he always was. And in that moment, I didn't hear God. God became so quiet. And I was suddenly just filled with this loneliness and this darkness. And in that moment in the ER, I didn't want to go on. I didn't want to experience life without my dad. And honestly, even now, I mean, it's been almost 11 months. I'm coming up on the 1 year next month of him passing away. And there are some times where I just can't even imagine how to keep going on without my dad. You know, knowing that he'll never walk me down the aisle, knowing that he'll never be able to see my future kids. That kind of stuff hurts me so deeply to my core. And I've asked God so many questions in these last 11 months. So many questions. A lot of them are why. Why would you allow this to happen, God? Why would you treat somebody like this who served you? He served in ministry his whole life. He loved his job as a pastor. Why would you treat one of your followers this way? And honestly, I've had a lot of anger and resentment towards God. I have oftentimes asked God to show me something, to give me some kind of answer to these why questions. And oftentimes I feel like Job. You know, when we read the story of Job, he's making these statements about how awful his life is, and he's wondering why. And that's how I have felt. I feel like I've been sitting in the ashes asking God why. And I think that it's important for me to be vulnerable with you all and share these questions, because I think so often as Christians, we're not vulnerable about our suffering and about the pain. And so I continue to ask why. I also wanted to share a picture with you all of my dad. This is my whole family, and that's my dad right there at our home church that he loved so much. And so for now, I continue asking why. And each time that I ask God that, I don't necessarily get any answers. But I keep asking. And maybe you can relate to asking some of those questions too.
Your love is great. I'm broken inside. I give you my life. Give me faith to trust what you say, that you're good and your love is great. I'm broken inside. I give you my life. And I may be weak, but your spirit's strong in me. And my flesh may fail, my God, you never will. And I may be weak, but your spirit's strong in me. And my flesh may fail, my God, you never will.
One of the hardest questions we wrestle with as Christians is, where is God when tragedy strikes our homes? If we believe in a sovereign God, then we know he could have intervened. He could have stopped an accident from happening, or cancer from spreading, or a loved one from dying, or even marriages from collapsing. He could have prevented COVID cases from increasing or companies from going under. And sometimes he does. Sometimes he shows up in these big, remarkable ways where all we can say is, wow, that is so God. God did that. But then there are those days where it seems like it takes forever for him to answer. And there are also times where we feel left alone in a hospital room or in our workplace or even in our homes. And we wonder if he's even there. There are times that we feel we are standing empty-handed, and then all we can do is crawl into his arms and just ask, where were you when I needed you the most? Or, how could you let this happen? Or even, why did you let him die? Earlier, Kylia shared her very painful experience with the loss of her dad. And I remember she called me when he was rushed to the hospital. And I was on the phone with her as she was on her way to Palm Desert. And I remember us praying and crying out to God, asking for healing, asking for him to intervene. And when she got there, I just told her, just text me as soon as you find out anything. And when I hung up on the phone with her, I remember kneeling down by my bed and just asking and begging and pleading for the Lord to do a miracle, to heal her dad. And this was way past midnight, but within minutes of that prayer, I got a text from her. And she said that he's gone. My heart sank. And just as she shared that she kept asking why, at that moment, I also asked why. You see, that year, I've already lost a couple of people that were dear to me. And I've had close friends lose a parent, even recently, my best friend's mom just passed away. And again, I asked the Lord why. I just didn't get it. Why do you heal some and not the others? We face suffering in this world, no matter what age or background. It comes in different sizes and shapes and different seasons in our lives, and they're all very painful. Just this past week, we experienced the most devastating news in all my years in the company I work for. Almost 800 layoffs, and which many of my friends were affected. The CEO announced a restructure, and within minutes, hundreds of positions were eliminated, hundreds of jobs gone. And I know so many of you are going through the same thing, especially with COVID climate right now. So many people are losing their jobs or already have lost their jobs. Some businesses are failing. And some of you are going through something that's not even COVID related. It could be a relationship that was lost, even though you tried so hard to make it work. Or it could be a sickness that just keeps getting worse no matter what medication you take. And these are moments of great confusion and even feelings of betrayal as we try to reason why a good and a loving father would allow his children to undergo such heartache. I am not going to pretend I know why, and I certainly don't have all the answers, because I've also wrestled with these same questions. I've asked questions before I became a Christian, and even now that I'm a Christian. I've wondered that if God is all-knowing and all-loving, why did he allow evil? And why did God put man on earth knowing that Adam and Eve will sin, therefore bringing evil and pain and suffering on all mankind? Why did he create angelic beings when he knew some of them would rebel? Why didn't God merely just create a world where suffering and evil didn't exist? And the answer is he did. In Genesis, when he looked at all of his creation, he said it was very good. So if God is not the author of pain or evil or death, then where did they all come from? See, part of God's creation are free creatures. He decided to give humans free will. We have freedom to choose to do good or choose to do evil, and evil is just the absence of good. He didn't want to be in relationship with him out of obligation. He didn't want robots that simply did what he wanted because of their programming. You know, if you pull a string of a teddy bear and it says, "I love you," it doesn't really mean anything because it's been programmed to say it. See, real love must involve a choice. Unfortunately, we humans have abused our free will by rejecting God and walking away from him. And that has resulted in two kinds of evils: moral evil and natural evil. And moral evil is when we choose to be hateful, selfish, arrogant, and even abusive. And natural evil are things like earthquakes and tornadoes and tsunamis that we know have destroyed thousands of lives. But it's because of sin that even nature was corrupted. So then some people ask, well, couldn't God have foreseen all of this? No doubt he did. He is all-knowing. But look at it this way. Many of you chose to be parents, even though there are risks involved. You know there was a really real possibility that your children will hurt you. Or sadly, there's a real possibility that they can even walk away from you. But you still chose to have kids. Why? Because you knew there was also the potential for tremendous joy and deep love and great meaning. And it's the same with God. He knew we'd rebel against him, but he also knew many people would choose to follow him and spend eternity in heaven with him. And that was worth it. But yet another question. I told you, I have a lot of questions. If God is all-powerful, why doesn't he just stop evil? See, just because evil is not destroyed right now, it does not mean that it never will be. Just because he hasn't done it yet doesn't mean he never will, that he won't do it. See, criticizing him for not stopping evil is like watching just half of a film and then blaming the director for not tying the loose ends of a plot. See, I'm not at all minimizing pain and suffering, but what helps me is to have a long-term perspective, an eternal perspective. The way the world is right now, this is not our permanent home. Thank God, you know? Romans 8:18 says, I consider that our present sufferings are not worth comparing with the glory that will be revealed in us. This was written by Paul, the Apostle Paul, who suffered through beatings and stonings and shipwrecks and homelessness and imprisonments and hunger, and I'm sure many days of loneliness. He experienced far more pain than any of us will ever endure. See, we suffer in this life, and faith doesn't protect us from that. But the Bible says that we can have hope. We can hope in the new heaven and the new earth, where there will be no more pain and suffering. This life is as a drop in the ocean compared with our eternal peace and joy and wholeness with God. I know these thoughts don't always comfort us when we suffer or when we've lost someone. Our finite minds cannot fully understand an infinite God. And sometimes we think we understand why God is doing something, only to find out later that it was for a completely different purpose than what we originally thought. But there are a few things I've learned through the Bible and from my own experience in why God does allow suffering. And the first one, it draws us closer to Him. Usually when there is suffering or a disaster, do nations and individuals turn back to God? Suffering can lead to repentance. When we are happy and trouble-free, how often do we forget God? How often? But when we suffer, when we experience heartache or loss or disappointment, we're more likely to turn to Him. And one of the hardest roles I've ever had, or I have in the story of my life, is being a single parent. And though my daughter Pauline is the greatest daughter anyone can ever have, can you tell I'm her mom? It's been very challenging to raise up a daughter when I was still growing up myself, because I was only a teenager and I was very young, still young, but I'm also in denial. But raising her as a teenager, it was very challenging financially, emotionally, physically, and mentally, because just trying to balance all the responsibilities since I was still finishing up school and then going to work full time, and then I had her. But this experience drew me so much closer to God. One very influential Christian leader, Johnny Erickson Tada, she's a quadriplegic, and she broke her neck when she was 17 in a diving accident. So she's paralyzed, neck down. And this is what she said about the pain that drew her to God. She said, I'd rather be in this wheelchair knowing God than on my feet without Him. The second reason I feel God allows suffering is to shape us. Picture a mom telling her child not to touch a hot stove because the mom knows it will hurt her. But the child touches it anyway. Child gets hurt, and most likely she won't do it again because of that pain she experienced. And that initial pain gave her an instant awareness of pain. And sometimes small pain is allowed to avoid the danger of bigger ones. If I'm honest with myself, a lot of the suffering I've gone through was because of wrong choices that I've made. I didn't wait on God's timing. I chose to do it my way, under my terms. And because God loves me, he disciplined me. It's part of the shaping and molding process. I've learned that I've had to go through certain types of suffering so I can make better choices later. Because sometimes we do learn the hard way. And honestly, I'm still learning. I often ask myself during times of suffering, what is God telling me? And is it something I need to change myself? The third thing is to bring out a greater good. Now, the suffering is not good, but God can accomplish something good out of it. See, the Old Testament gives us a great example in the story of Joseph. And as a church, we just studied his life recently. Joseph went through terrible suffering, being sold into slavery by his own brothers. And even though he worked hard and did everything right, he was falsely accused. And then falsely imprisoned and forgotten by the person that said they were going to help him. Now, but God didn't forget Joseph. And after a dozen years or so, he was put in a role of great authority where he could save the lives of his family and many others. This is what he said to his brothers about his suffering. You intended to harm me, but God intended it for good, to accomplish what is now being done, the saving of many lives. Suffering is not good at all, and it is painful, but God can cause something good to come out of it. God proved it by taking the worst thing that's ever happened in the history of the universe, which is the death of his son, and turn it into the very best thing that has happened in the history of the universe. Salvation for anyone who believed. So if God can take the very worst and turn it into the very best, can he not take the negative circumstances in your life and create something good from them? The last thing I feel God allows suffering is so we may comfort others. In 2 Corinthians, Paul says, God comforts us every time we have trouble, every time, so that when others have trouble, we can comfort them with the same comfort God gives us. Now, how comforting is it to talk to someone who has overcome the same trial that you're going through, someone who's walked in your shoes, someone who's been there and understand. See, your greatest trial could be your next platform for ministry. Because I have experienced poverty and abuse and breakups and loss of a loved one and loss of a job, I am able to tell someone, I understand. And it opens amazing conversations about God and his grace. Now, I understand knowing all these reasons doesn't take away the pain. And I get that. And you may say, well, it's unfair. It's unfair that my spouse had to die just for these reasons. Or it's unfair my child had to get sick. Or that I lost my job that I worked so hard in just so I can be drawn closer to him. Just so I can comfort others. And you're probably right. It does seem unfair. And I'm going to use two profound words. It sucks. But was it fair that Jesus, who knew no sin, had to die a humiliating death for the penalty of our sins? That probably wasn't fair either. But I'm sure Jesus would say, it was worth it. You're worth it. Overall, we see things from our limited perspective. We wonder why God is allowing pain in our lives. I remember in the Philippines when I think I was about 8 years old, I was playing basketball in the Korner street by my house, and there was a drunk driver rushing towards me and my friends. And as I tried to get away, I slipped. And so the vehicle ran over my left foot. I have never felt so much excruciating pain in my life. Well, until I gave birth, that is. But when I was in the hospital and they were operating on me, I remember screaming and yelling at the nurses and the doctor and telling them to stop, stop. And it was because I just felt the pain was getting worse. They were making it worse. And I had no idea that they were actually trying to save this little bone on my foot so they wouldn't have to amputate my leg. See, the doctor saw the big picture. He knew what he was doing. I was very limited in what I can see and understand because I was so focused on my pain. Just like the doctor who saw what was needed to be done, God sees the big picture. We may not understand it at that time, but in Isaiah, he says, "My thoughts are nothing like your thoughts, says the Lord, and my ways are far beyond anything you could imagine. For just as the heavens are higher than the earth, so my ways are higher than your ways, and my thoughts higher than your thoughts." So again, knowing all this may not help alleviate any of your pain. You may be saying, "But Merlinda, it still hurts. And I don't feel God is with me." So the ultimate question, where is God when it hurts? He's with us. God is with us. One of the very first scripture I memorized is Isaiah 41:10. And he says, "Do not fear, for I am with you. Do not be dismayed, for I am your God. I will strengthen you and help you. I will uphold you with my righteous right hand." I remember going through a very difficult season in my life. 4-year relationship fell apart. I lost my job unfairly. I had to let go of my apartment. And I had a couple of friends betray me as well. And these things all happened just months apart. And talk about when it rains, it pours. A lot of Christians refer it to our Job season in our lives. One night after crying my heart out, I mean, it was ugly crying, not pretty. And when I finally fell asleep, I had a dream. I had a dream. I was in my bedroom and it was dark, except for one lamp that was lit in the corner. I saw myself sitting on the floor in the corner of my room with my hugging my knees and my head bent down. I was in such despair and brokenness. Then I saw what I had interpreted as an image of Jesus. He bent down and sat beside me. He didn't say a word, but he didn't have to because his presence was comforting enough. He didn't try to explain anything either. He just sat with me in silence. And then after some time, he reached out his hand and he said, "Merle," which is the name my family calls me, "Merle, it's time. It's time to leave this place." God spoke to me so much in that dream, and I know God speaks to us in many different ways. But that day, he reassured me that he heard my cries, and he was right there. Jesus was there when I was still broken and processing things, and he didn't pressure me to get over it. He didn't shame me by saying I didn't have enough faith, and he didn't rush me either. And the best thing is, he didn't leave me in that condition. See, after some time, when he stood up and he reached out his hand, his righteous right hand, I knew I had to accept the situation I was in. Even though I don't have it all figured out, even though I don't have all the answers. And do you know how hard that is for me? Because I have questions and I have answers. I need to find solutions to things. But I needed to be okay with not knowing why things were happening the way they were. Now, when he reached out his hand, it was him saying, "I needed to move forward," and that I wasn't going to do it alone, that he was going to be there through it all. As we sang earlier, there's another in the fire with me. There's a story in the Bible about three siblings, Lazarus, Mary, and Martha. And Lazarus had died, but Jesus was away at the time of his death. And by the time Jesus arrived into their town, Lazarus had already been dead for 4 days. Upon hearing of Jesus' arrival, this is what Mary does in John 11. When Mary reached the place where Jesus was and saw him, she fell at his feet and said, "Lord, if you had been here, my brother would not have died." When Jesus saw her weeping, the Jews who had come along were also weeping. He was deeply moved in spirit and troubled. "Where have you laid him?" he asked. "Come and see, Lord," they replied. Jesus wept. Now, if you continue with the story, you will know that Jesus does raise Lazarus from the dead. But I just want to focus on the dialogue between Mary and Jesus for now. Jesus knew Lazarus was sick because Mary and Martha had sent word to him. But he didn't show up to their home until 4 days later, after Lazarus had already died. Now, Mary knew that Jesus could have healed her brother before he died and wondered why he hadn't shown up when they needed him. She believed and felt let down by Jesus. And instead of pushing these emotions of disappointment aside, she confronted those complicated feelings and was honest with him. She told him that if he had been there sooner, her brother would have been healed. But instead of reprimanding Mary, Jesus was moved by her. He saw the raw pain behind that question and the heart that was aching. She wanted to know where he was, why he wasn't there. See, behind Mary's statement, "If you had been here," is the aching question, "Why weren't you here? Did you even care? Were other people more important than us that you didn't drop what you were doing to come help us?" Now, that's me speculating. That's just me thinking that's how Mary would have felt, because when we don't feel God's healing touch, when we don't see the intervention we pray for, when our deep fears unfold, most of the time we feel abandoned and we wonder, "Do you even care, Lord?" But Jesus saw the brokenness in Mary's life and the heart behind her statement. And don't get me wrong, I don't think Mary was speaking with a tone of anger or accusation. I feel that it was really coming from a deep hurt, and Jesus felt that she was hurting. In fact, he wept too. Shortest scripture in the Bible, Jesus wept. And even though only minutes later her brother would walk out of his tomb miraculously, Jesus didn't say, "Oh, Mary, stop crying. Don't worry. I'm going to raise him. Relax." He didn't do any of that. He simply had compassion for Mary and her brokenness. See, God is big enough to handle our confusion and pain. He can handle our questions, wondering where he is. He can handle our broken emotions. And not only can God handle our emotions, but he weeps with us when we are in pain. He doesn't simply point to the end result to remind us that everything is going to be all right, so to neglect what we're feeling right now. He steps into the pain of the moment and recognizes the brokenness that he came to redeem. It's okay to be honest with God when your world collapses and you're wondering where he is, because no one knows the brokenness of the world more than Jesus. He may not have intervened the way Mary had hoped for, but he did intervene eventually. But I loved what he did in between. He wept with her, because even though her brokenness was temporary, he knew it was real. Where is God when it hurts? Again, he is with us, and he also suffers with us. No one has been more crushed by the weight of sin than Jesus, who was beaten and bruised and brutally slaughtered for our sins. Someone said he was God who became man in the flesh and had to bear under the burdens of the flesh. He was tempted as all men. He left a realm of all power, all knowledge, all presence, so he can be here in this world and learn to walk as a little child and learn to talk. He hungered. He got tired. He needed to sleep. He wept. He ate. He felt deep pain. He felt betrayal. And he may have felt the loss of his earthly father, because the last mention of Joseph was when he was 12 in the synagogue. And then at the cross, he told one of his disciples to take care of his earthly mother, Mary. So Joseph may have passed away by then. And if that's the case, then he felt the loss of a loved one. But Jesus also felt the pain of the whips upon his back. And they beat him as they beat him unmercifully and nailed him at the cross. See, God isn't some distant, detached God. He entered into our world and into our pain. He came down to where we are. Philip Yancey said, "The fact that Jesus came to earth where he suffered and died does not remove pain from our lives. But it does show that God did not sit idly by and watch us suffer in isolation. He became one of us. Thus, in Jesus, God gives us an up-close and personal look at his response to human suffering. All our questions about God and suffering should, in fact, be filtered through what we know about Jesus. Our hurts can become the very place where we meet God and experience the intimacy of his comforting presence. When you pass through the waters, he says, I will be with you. And when you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. See, God doesn't promise deliverance from or avoidance of all pain. He does not always intervene the way we would want him to. But in the time that when we do hurt, he weeps with us and comforts us in the midst of our pain. Sometimes he uplifts our spirit through the kindness of others. It could be a friend just texting, hey, praying for you. Sometimes he brings a sense of peace that we could never have or sustain on our own. Sometimes through a glimpse of beauty, like a beautiful sunset, or a well-timed word of encouragement or scripture, he reassures us that we are so loved and that we're going to be okay. That you are so loved and you're going to be okay. As I close, one philosopher said, I believe all suffering is at least potential good, an opportunity for good. It's up to our free choice to actualize that potential. Not all of us benefit from suffering and learning from it, because that's up to us. It's up to our free will. With Jesus, in my dream that I told you about, when he told me it's time to leave this place, he meant I had to make a choice to move forward. We make the choice to either run away from God or to run to him. And when we do run to him, John 16:33 says, these things I have spoken to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but take courage. Take courage, because I have overcome the world. Will you pray with me? Father, I just thank you so much for this time together. Thank you that we can come to you with our questions, with our hurts. And although at times we don't understand why things happen the way they do, I pray, Lord, that you give us faith to trust in your ways, to trust in your process, to trust in your plans, to trust in your character and your goodness, and to trust in your timing. And I just pray, Lord, that whatever everyone is going through right now, I ask, Father, that you, that your sweet, comforting presence just fill them. For those who may need a miracle, for those who may need healing, or a relationship restored, or financial provision, or protection, whatever the pain, whatever the need may be, I pray, Lord God, that each one would know they're not alone, that you're right there with him, that your righteous right hand will uphold them. Thank you, Lord God, for giving us the strength to endure. And thank you, Lord, for being with us during times of suffering, and also for weeping with us and understanding our pain, but not leaving us there either. Thank you for giving us hope and courage, because you have overcome the world. So thank you so much. We love you, and we pray all of this in your son's most precious and sweetest name. In Jesus' name, amen.
Oceans rise, my soul will rest in your embrace.
Church, thank you so much for worshiping with us today. Please be sure to check out the announcements at the end. We would love to connect with you. And as always, if you need prayer, please email us or leave us a Facebook comment. And lastly, I would like to leave you with one question. Two. Instead of asking, where is God when it hurts, let's ask ourselves, where is the church when it hurts? Where are you when people around you are hurting? See, we form the front line of God's response to a suffering world. So as you start your week, let's remember what Hebrews says, to see to it that no one misses the grace of God. God bless you, and we'll see you next week. Bye.
You can do it.